Good. So today we have good fortune of having His Grace Adigadatta Prabhu on this call. So he will be enlightening us on the Srimad Bhagavatam. So please, Prabhuji, take over the call. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Thank you very much, Ishwari Kumari Mataji.
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskrityam Naram Chaiva Narottamam Devim Saraswatim Vyasam Tato Jayam Mudiraye. Nashtaprayeshu Abhadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. Bhagavati Ruttama Shloke Bhaktir Bhavati Naishthiki. Vasudeva Paraveda Vasudeva Paramaka Vasudeva Parayoga Vasudeva Parakriya Vasudeva Param Jnanam Vasudeva Param Tapa Vasudeva Paro Dharmo Vasudeva Paragati. Krishnaya Vasudevaya Devaki Nandanaya cha Nanda Gopa Kumaraya Govinda Namo Namaha. Namo Pankajana Bhaya Namo Pankaja Maline Namo Pankaja Netraya Namaste Pankajangraye. Aradhyo Bhagavan Vraje Shatanayas Taddhama Vrindavanam Ramya Kachidupasana Vrajavadhu Varagenaya Kalpita. Srimad Bhagavatam Pramanamamalam Premaha Pumarato Maha. Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhur Matamidam Tatradara Para. Hare Krishna. We are continuing studying Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam. We will be studying 3 verses today. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 4, Chapter 6, verse number 5, 6, and 7. Verse number 5, Brahmaji. Lord Brahma, he is speaking to the demigods who had participated in the Daksha Yajna. So Brahmaji is telling the demigods.
Athapi yoyam kritakil vishabhavam ye barhi shobha Bhajam Paradu Prasadayatvam Aparishuddha Chetasa Shipra Prasadam Pragitangri Padmam.
Translation and purports. By His Divine Grace, Abhay Charanaravinda Bhakti Vedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation: you have excluded Lord Shiva from taking part in the sacrificial results, and therefore you are all offenders at his lotus feet. Still, if you go without mental reservations and surrender unto him and fall down at his lotus feet, he will be very pleased. Purport. Lord Shiva is also called Ashutosha. Ashu means very soon, and Tosha means to become satisfied. The demigods were advised to go to Lord Shiva and beg his pardon. And because he is very easily pleased, it was certain that their purpose would be served. Lord Brahma knew the mind of Lord Shiva very well, and he was confident that the demigods who were offenders at his lotus feet could mitigate their offenses by going to him and surrendering without reservation. Om Adhyanati Mirandhasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmay Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yutapada Kamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajata Sahagana Raghunathan Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Pada Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prishthaya Bhutale Shrimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Sarasvate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripasindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Namo Maha Vadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namne Gaura Kise Namaha Pancha Tattva Atmakam Krishnam Bhakta Rupa Swarupakam Bhakta Avataram Bhaktakhyam Namami Bhakta Shaktikam He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dinabandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Urishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare 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 Krishna. I would like to offer my respectful
obeisances at the lotus feet of all the devotees who are listening. I also beg at your lotus feet with folded hands to please kindly shower your blessings upon me so that by the strength of your merciful blessings for the next few minutes, Shri Guru and Shri Gauranga may bestow the right intelligence upon me so that I may be able to speak on Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam in such a way that all our hearts become purified and all our hearts become attracted to the lotus feet of Shri Guru and Shri Gauranga. Thank you very much.
Gurave Gaura Chandraya Radhikaya Tadalaye Krishnaya Krishna Bhaktaya Tad Bhaktaya Namo Namaha.
Hare Krishna. We are reading this very instructive section of Srimad Bhagavatam, where Daksha committed a great offense by criticizing, insulting, humiliating Lord Shiva, who is a guna avatar, who is an incarnation of Krishna, a very special type of incarnation. Such an incarnation that he is actually the greatest devotee of Krishna. Vaishnavanam Yatha Shambhu. Daksha not only criticized Lord Shiva, but he also offended Mother Sati, the wife of Lord Shiva, who also happened to be Daksha's own daughter. Such is the nature of Vaishnava Aparadha. One mistake gives birth to another mistake. Similarly, one Vaishnava Aparadha contaminates our consciousness so much that it can give birth to the propensity to commit more and more and more Vaishnava Aparadhas in the future. So Daksha offended Shivji. Shivji just got up and left. And sometime later, when Daksha met Mother Sati, he offended her as well. He broke her heart as well. He pierced her heart with the sharp dagger of indifference. This is the nature of Vaishnava Aparadha. It puts us in a very, very dangerous situation. Very dangerous situation. It is better not to get there, not to get into such a situation. Prevention is better than cure. So when Mother Sati leaves her body due to being offended by Daksha, the followers of Shivji come there and they kill Daksha and they destroy the whole yajna. So all the demigods who were participating in that yajna, they are aghast by this destruction caused by the followers of Lord Shiva. And they quickly go to Lord Brahma and tell him everything, although Brahmaji already knew what had happened. But they went and told Lord Brahma what had happened and sought his help. Lord Brahma, being a Mahajan, being a great devotee, did not mince words. These demigods were severely beaten up. Their leader, the main Prajapati Daksha, he was beheaded, he was murdered, he was killed. Their sacrifice was disrupted and disturbed. So much trouble these demigods had gone through. And all these demigods are devotees of Krishna. That is why they are demigods. They are empowered by Krishna. They are pious people. They are dharmic people. They are engaged in religious activities. They are knowledgeable. They are cultured. They do their sadhana. And all these demigods have been beaten up. Daksha has been killed. The yajna has been disrupted. And they are going to Brahmaji in such a difficult situation, begging him for protection and help. And Brahmaji gives them a full dose. Brahmaji does not mince words. Brahmaji does not sugarcoat things. Brahmaji, being a Mahajan, chastises the demigods when they are wrong. He tells them the diagnosis. My dear demigods, you had to go through all this trouble, all this pain, all this suffering, because you are all offenders. Brahmaji does not say that only Daksha was offender. No. Yes, Daksha instigated the offense. Daksha started the Vaishnava Aparadha. But by supporting Daksha, by not speaking up in favor of true dharma, by being silent participants, silent spectators, the demigods also were implicated in the Vaishnava Aparadha. You see, the laws of this world are not always black and white. In fact, things are not always black and white. We have to understand the rules, the laws from the law books. One can argue, I am a doctor, I am performing abortions. What is my fault? The government authorizes it. Performing abortions is legal. I am not doing anything illegal. My medical teachers have taught me, my professors have taught me, the university has taught me. So many hospitals are doing it. Besides, I am not going and preaching to people that you should have an abortion. People are coming to me. Patients are coming to me to get abortion. It is their choice. If I don't do it, someone else will do it. If no doctor does it, they will go to some quacks. Some people who are not proper doctors, and they will do it in a wrong way, leading to so many infections, complications, and even death of the mother. So I'm just doing my part. I'm doing something that is authorized. I'm doing something that is legal. I'm doing something that I have been trained to do, and I'm doing something that the patients are asking me to do. I'm not going to them. They are coming to me. I'm not forcing. we can give so many justifications and explanations. But who cares about these justifications and explanations? Who cares? Is Yamaraj going to care? Are the Yamadutas going to care? We have to understand the laws that govern all of us from the law books. And the law books are not books that some politicians have sat down and written down when the constitution of a country is created a few hundred years ago, or a century ago, or half a century ago. Who cares about that constitution? In the giant scheme of things, who cares? These constitutions are created by imperfect human beings. These constitutional laws governing different countries are amended time and again. There are so many amendments, first amendment, second amendment, third. Because these laws are not perfect, they have to be adjusted, they have to be amended. Yes, we all must follow the laws of the land. It is essential. But at the same time, if drinking alcohol is legal, there are licensed taverns which sell alcohol. If abortions are legal, there are licensed physicians who are performing them. If smoking is legal, it does not mean that we do it. Yes, we have to follow the laws of the land, but we also have to harmonize the laws of the land with the eternal laws, perfect laws given to us by Krishna. Yes, we follow the constitution of our country. We follow all the laws. But we also follow the eternal laws, which are not in some constitution or law book of some country or some university or law school. But these laws are given to us through revealed scriptures. Revealed scriptures are not written by some mortal, some fallible human being. Revealed scriptures come from the infallible Lord Himself. Vedanta Krit Veda Ved Eva Cham. We have to follow those laws also. So the demigods may not have spoken harsh words against Lord Shiva themselves. The demigods may not have been indifferent and harsh and disrespectful towards Mother Sati, but they were all implicated in the Vaishnava Aparadha, and they all had to pay a collective price. They all have to suffer collectively. This is how the laws of nature work. We have to understand these laws. We have to understand these do's and don'ts from the revealed scriptures and from our acharyas and mahajans. Brahmaji was very blunt with these demigods. He told them, "You are offenders. How can you expect to be happy? You deserve this suffering. Now, without any reservations, go to Lord Shiva. Fall down at his lotus feet."
Shipra prasadam pragita angri padmam.
Angri means lotus feet. Padmam means lotus. Angri means feet. Padma means lotus. Go and fall down at his lotus feet and beg forgiveness. Without any reservations. That is very important. without any reservations means with an open mind. Yes. Unconditional apology. Unconditional apology. I have made a mistake. I'm sorry. We need such people in our lives. Acharyas like Lord Brahma who will tell us bluntly, without sugarcoating, Prabhu, you are in Maya. Prabhu, you are too attached to prestige, appreciation, glorification, distinction. Prabhu, you are acting out of envy. Please don't be envious like this. Prabhu, you have become proud. We need people in our life who will tell us this. If we don't have, we should find out who is that devotee who is senior to us, who is more advanced, spiritually more experienced, more mature, who is fixed up in his or her bhajan and who can guide us. We should all have such advanced devotees in our life. Very, very essential. And when we have such Shiksha Gurus in our life, we must have the determination to go to them for help. Just like the demigods went to Lord Brahma and they are humbly hearing from him and they are going to obey the solution that Brahmaji is going to give them, the instructions that Brahmaji is going to give them. They are going to follow those instructions. It's very important. And then in the purport, Srila Prabhupada beautifully explains that Lord Shiva is Ashutosh. He is very easily satisfied, very easily pleased. He forgives very easily. Bahut bhole hai. Shankar Bhagavan. It's called Bhola. that is how devotees are. Devotees are very simple by heart, very forgiving. And Lord Shiva exemplifies who a Vaishnava is. So when I was thinking about this verse, I was telling myself, if I cannot forgive, then I am not trying to be a Vaishnava. Very easy to say, we are Gaudiya Vaishnavas. But we have to think, what is the standard to be a Gaudiya Vaishnava? Who is a Vaishnava? If we cannot forgive, then we are not representing Ashutosh. We are not representing Lord Shiva. Vaishnavana Anitha Shambhu. Shivji is the topmost devotee of Krishna. He gave us the Shri Radhika Kripa Kataksha Stotra. Who is Lord Shiva? He is such a confidential, He is the greatest devotee. He is protecting Rasleela as Gopeshwar Mahadev. Shivji is teaching us that we have to be forgiving. So in our day-to-day dealings, in ISKCON, in our congregation, if we are not able to forgive, then we are not devotees. Hare Krishna. Because Shivji is so forgiving, is Ashutosh. Is so simple-hearted. So in our day-to-day dealings, yes, we have to be careful. You know, we are conditioned souls. We have a tendency to exploit each other, manipulate each other. It's very difficult. Then we forgive, then we let go, and then the same thing is repeated. We are offended in exactly the same way by the same person again. It becomes very painful. Very difficult to be humble when others are not. humble. Very difficult to be adosha darshi. A Vaishnava is adosha darshi, does not see faults in others, does not engage in fault finding. But very difficult to be adosha darshi when there are so many dosh in the devotees around us. We just want to appreciate, glorify devotees. But when devotees have nasty qualities also, in addition to their good qualities, and those nasty qualities are disturbing us, it's very difficult to not notice them. Very difficult not to get bothered by those behavioral traits. What to do? This is the test that Krishna has given us. We have to reconcile somehow. We have to reconcile to the fact that yes, these are devotees. They are chanting Hare Krishna. They are serving Krishna's deity. They are doing service in their own way. And unfortunately, I am noticing these bad qualities in them. If it is disturbing me, if it is disturbing the lives of other devotees, and I have a relationship with that devotee, I should go. And motivated by love, motivated by the intention to help that devotee, give them a feedback carefully. If I don't have that relationship, if I don't have that position of spiritual authority, let me confidentially go to someone who does and tell that person to tell this devotee to improve, to observe Vaishnava etiquette, to be careful not to offend others. And we have to be tolerant. Diksha and Karunaika. At the same time, we have to be merciful also. Merciful to the devotee by praying for them, by being their well-wisher, and merciful to ourselves by not getting contaminated, by not seeing things black and white. Either you are a very good devotee or you are a demon. Black or white. We have to, there are lots of shades of grey in this world. In fact, we are all grey. We are devotees, or trying to be devotees, and we still have so many conditionings, so many imperfections, so many weaknesses. So we have to see them wholesome. We have to see the big picture that yes, these problems are there, but at the end of the day, he or she is a devotee of Krishna. The aim is not to prove that this person is wrong and label him permanently as Mr. Wrong or Mrs. Wrong. No. Aim is to purify, to improve, to help advance together, because we are also going to make mistakes. We are also going to commit Vaishnava operas. That famous story where there was a prostitute, and she was found out that she's a prostitute. So all the people, they wanted to lynch her. Lynch her means they are going to take stones and throw stones at her, hit her, and stone her to death publicly, so that no one else will have illicit sex. And this prostitute had faith in Jesus Christ. This was when Jesus Christ was present on this planet. And she surrendered to Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ looked at the angry people who wanted to throw stones at her and lynch her to death. And he told them, throw the stones and kill her. But let that person throw the first stone at her who has never committed a sin. And everybody was silent. Everybody lowered their hands and dropped the stones. That was the mood of Lord Jesus Christ. We have to be compassionate. We have to be tolerant. We have to see things as they are. We have to see people as they are, not just black and white. Either you are good or you are bad. No, don't work like that. So these scriptures, they help us understand that even a great demigod like Daksha can commit mistakes. Even demigods commit Vaishnava Aparadha and they come into trouble. See, Bhagavatam not only describes the activities, the bad activities of Kamsa, the bad activities of Ashwatthama, the bad activities of Kaliya, the bad activities of all these demons like Jarasandh, Agasur, Bakasur. Srimad Bhagavatam not just describes the bad activities of Hiranyakashipu, Hiranyaksha, but Srimad Bhagavatam also describes the bad activities of Indradev, the bad activities of Daksha Prajapati, the bad activities of the demigods, the mistakes of the demigods also. So we should take hope that even the demigods make mistakes. Even the demigods who are devotees, who are empowered by Krishna, even they make mistakes. So what is my position and what is the position of other devotees in ISKCON around me? Why should I hold it against them if they make mistakes? We are all patients in this hospital. Srila Prabhupada is our doctor. And there are many other doctors and nurses and medical assistants who are helping Srila Prabhupada, who are assisting Srila Prabhupada in his mission. And Krishna has funded this hospital. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has created this hospital. He is supplying all the medicines. Mahaprabhu, Nityananda Prabhu, Duijana, these two brothers, Paramakaruna Bahu Duijana Nitai Gaura Chandra, they are supplying all the medicines. Golokera Premadhana Hari Nama Sankirtana, they have given all the medicines. They have funded this hospital. They own this hospital. And Srila Prabhupada is our doctor. And this doctor, this physician, Srila Prabhupada, is assisted by other assistant doctors, nurses, medical assistants, Prabhupada disciples, temple presidents, Shiksha gurus, counselors. Yes, we are all assisting. We are all patients. We are all patients. We have to forgive if there is a mistake. Otherwise, we are not devotees. If we cannot forgive, then we are not devotees. You will never find any example in the scriptures. Never. Never, never. You will never find any example in the scripture that someone was sent eternally to hell with no hope ever. Just a We may give up hope, but Krishna does not give up hope. Krishna never gives up on us. He's always there with us as the Paramatma. It is said that every saint has a past. Look at Valmiki Muni, such a great saint, wrote the first Geet, the first Kavita, the first poem, 24,000 verses in perfect meter. Valmiki Muni. Lord Ramchandra loved him so much that he sent his own eternal wife, Srimati Sita Devi, to live under Valmiki Muni's care and shelter. This Valmiki Muni also did not drop from the spiritual world as a perfect sadhu. He had a past. He was a robber. He was a criminal. His name was Ratnakar. So every saint has a past. Every saint has a past. And every sinner has a future. You should know, if we sin, we will have to suffer in hell. Every saint has a past and every sinner has a future. We can also see this in a different way. Every saint has a past also means that this saint is today a saint because in the past he has gone through intense sadhana, intense purification. Valmiki Muni sat and chanted Ram, 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 Ram. Can you imagine? An anthill is formed around you. Intense sadhana. Followed the instructions of a spiritual master, Narada. It just didn't become Valmiki overnight. So every saint has a past. Every saint has got intense austerity. Tapo Divyam. Intense tapasya to become a sadhu. How much Srila Prabhupada has gone through. It's not like Prabhupada was born as a jet age Parivrajak Acharya. It's not that Prabhupada was just came from the spiritual world directly as I am Jagat Guru, Srila Prabhupada. If we study Srila Prabhupada Lilabrit, a lifetime in preparation, crying out alone in the wilderness. How much tapasya Srila Prabhupada has gone through. What intense rounds he chanted at Advaita Bhavan in Shantipur. What intense japa he did at the Samadhi Mandir of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur. What intense prayers he wrote on Jaladuta ship. What austerities unimaginable. At the age of 70 years. So every saint has a past. Also means every saint has gone through so much sadhana, intense bhajan to become a sadhu. And every sinner has a future also from a different angle if you look at it. Every sinner has a future also means that every sinner has a hope. Every sinner has a hope. Yes, Nala Kuver and Manigreve appeared naked, intoxicated, full of lust in front of Narad Muni. And yes, they were cursed to become trees for 1,000 celestial years. sinners, offenders, proud, lusty, egoistic people, sinners. But every sinner has a future. Every sinner has a hope. If we are truly repentant, if we take shelter of Guru, Sadhu and Shastra, every sinner has hope. But we should go with an open mind, without reservations, and beg forgiveness, like the demigods are doing. Then, Nalakuvar and Manigrave, they witnessed the childhood activities of Krishna. How he devoured Putana. How he delivered Shakatasur. How he delivered Trinavrata. How he used to play in the cow dung and cow urine of the cows in the Goshala of Nanda Baba. He is the original jet ski. People like to do jet skiing, water surfing, and I don't know what it is called. They are pulled by this powerful boat, or so many skating they do. It's a perverted reflection of the original enjoyment that Krishna and Balram eternally enjoy in Goloka Vrindavan, holding on to the tail of their beloved devotee cows and being pulled, dragged through, skiing through the pure cow dung and cow urine. All friends, all gopis laughing and clapping when they do that. Nalakuvar and Manigrave got to witness that. They actually got to witness how Krishna stole butter, how he broke the butter pots, how he was feeding the monkeys. They got to see all this. They actually got to see Mother Yashoda chasing Damodar all around the courtyard. And Krishna running with tears in his eyes. Nalakuvar and Manigrave actually got to see Mother Yashoda extending her hand and grabbing Krishna. And Krishna breathing heavily, crying, rubbing his eyes, rubbing the tears, and all the mascara getting smeared on his beautiful cheeks. These lusty, egoistic, proud, naked sense gratifiers actually got to see all this. Why? Because they got the merciful glance of Narad Muni. Only a pure devotee can give us entrance into the eternal blissful Leela of Krishna. Yadi papi dharma chadi tadure deshayaya mora senapati bhakta tathaivayaya. Lochan Das Thakur quotes Chaitanya Mahaprabhu saying, if the sinful people leave dharma and go and settle in far away countries, yadi papi dharma chadi dure deshayaya mora senapati bhakta, at that time I will send my senapati, my commander in chief devotee, and he will cross the seas and he will go to those far away countries and deliver those sinful people. Jagat Guru Srila Prabhupada ki jai. So every sinner has a future. You need to have an open mind and approach and beg for forgiveness from the person who we have offended. After our eyes have been opened by our well-wishing devotee friends or our Guru Maharaj or our Shiksha Gurus, our mentors, counselors, whoever, we need such people who will tell it to us as it is for our benefit. We go to the next verse, verse number 6.
Asha Shana Jivittam Adhavarayasya Loka Sapalaha Upite Nayasmin Tam Ashudevam Priyaya Vihinam Shama Payadvam Ridivittam Durukte.
Translation. Lord Brahma also advised them that Lord Shiva is so powerful that by his anger all the planets and their chief controllers can be destroyed immediately. Also, he said that Lord Shiva was especially sorry because he had recently lost his dear wife and was also very much afflicted by the unkind words of Daksha. Under the circumstances, Lord Brahma suggested it would behoove them to go at once and beg his pardon. Brahmaji is so sweet. Brahmaji is so wonderful. Brahmaji is so merciful to all of us. What a brilliant insight Brahmaji is giving us in this verse. Brahmaji is telling the demigods that yes, my dear demigods, you have been beaten up by the followers of Lord Shiva. You have been insulted by the followers of Lord Shiva. Your yajna has been disrupted by the followers of Lord Shiva. Yes, you are the victims. However, just think about Lord Shiva also. Lord Shiva, because of all of you, has lost his beloved wife, Mother Sati. Lord Shiva's heart has been pierced by the dagger-like sharp words of Daksha and his followers. So even Shivji is pained. Even Shivji is a victim. How wonderful this is. How essential this is for all of us to remember and understand when we are interacting with devotees. Sometimes a devotee, we feel, has offended us, is trying to harm us, has belittled us, has humiliated us, has not treated us properly. We feel a devotee has treated us with disrespect. And our whole mission is to expose that devotee, to make sure all other devotees understand and are convinced how bad this devotee is. But at such times, we have to understand the situation from the perspective of the other devotee also. It is possible that that devotee also is going through some crisis. It is possible that that devotee also is suffering a lot of pain. it is possible that we have done something to that devotee that has hurt that devotee a lot. It is possible that we, by our actions, have brought out the worst in that devotee. That is what Brahmaji is teaching us. He's telling the demigods, yes, you are victims, but please know that Lord Shiva also has just lost his wife. How many of you have lost your wives? Lord Shiva has been insulted by the sharp words of Daksha. How many of you have been insulted like that? So Brahmaji is telling them that you are all thinking that Lord Shiva sent his followers to destroy all, and you have suffered so much at the hands of Lord Shiva's followers. But please understand what Lord Shiva is going through. He has just lost his wife. This is very essential for all of us in our Vaishnava dealings. We have to be very sensitive. We have to be very sensitive, my dear friends. We have to bring out the good in others. You see, when Lord Ramchandra, along with Lakshman, when he was searching for Mother Sita, after Mother Sita was abducted by the evil Ravan, they met Sugriv. Sugriv also had lost his wife. Vali had taken Sugriv's wife. Sugriv also had lost his kingdom, Kishkindha Kshetra. Vali had kicked him out of the kingdom. Due to the palace intrigue, even Lord Ram had to leave his palace and leave Ayodhya. So Sugriv and Ram were more or less in the same situation. So Sugriv could identify with the pain that Ram was feeling. Although, from the point of view of rasa, from the point of view of leela, this is true, but from the point of view of tattva, this is not exactly as it appears, because the emotions, the mood, the feelings of Lord Ram are not similar to that of Sugriv. What Vipralamba Bhav Lord Ram is tasting after Mother Sita was taken away is completely spiritual emotion. In fact, it is the highest spiritual rasa, Vipralamba Bhav. Sugriv was not on that platform. No one can be on that platform. No Jivatma can be on that platform. But at least from the Leela standpoint, the Ramayana describes that Ram and Sugriv had suffered similar setbacks in their lives. So they could relate to each other and their friendship was natural. So when they met, Sugriv invited Lord Ram on the Rishyamukha mountain, where he had taken refuge, safe from the attacks of Vali. So Sugriv invited Lord Ram to the Rishyamukha mountain where he was staying, and he immediately broke the branch of a tree and put it on the ground as a log for Lord Ram to sit on. And he broke another branch and he himself sat down. And they both started talking. Sugriv said, I will help you find Mother Sita, but please help me get my wife back, get my kingdom back. And Lord Ramchandra said yes. But when this important discussion was going on, Sugriv made a mistake. He lacked sensitivity. He paid all attention to Lord Ram, but he completely neglected Lakshman. He gave a sitting place to Lord Ram, but he did not offer anything to Lakshman. But Sugriv was fortunate that he had a minister, an advisor like Hanumanji. Hanumanji, being very sensitive, did not point out the mistake of Sugriv in front of everyone. It would have been very embarrassing. It would have added a lot of brownie points in Hanumanji's account. Oh, he's so good, he's so intelligent, he has such etiquette. And it would have put Sugriv down in the eyes of others. But Hanumanji did not do that. He was not after cheap brownie points. Hanumanji did not point out the mistake of Sugriv. On the contrary, he silently went, broke another branch of a tree. As a log, he put it down and offered it as a sitting place for Lakshman. Lakshman accepted this hospitality, this sensitivity, this courtesy from Hanumanji. And then Hanumanji sat down himself on the ground at the lotus feet of Lakshman. Just imagine, Sugriv and Ram are talking. Hanumanji quietly goes, gets a sitting place for Lakshman, seats him right next to Ram, and then he himself sits down at the lotus feet of Lakshman. Sugriv did not even notice all this because he was engrossed in discussing strategy and plan with Lord Ram. But Lord Ram very much noticed this. And he cast his sidelong glance upon Hanumanji and smiled approvingly. Lord Ramchandra noticed and he approved this wonderful behavior of Hanumanji. And when Lord Ramchandra told Sugriv to go and fight with Vali, Lord Ramchandra did not shoot his arrow. He allowed Sugriv to get bashed up and beaten by Vali. Somehow, barely Sugriv managed to escape with his life. And when he met Lord Ram, Lord Ramchandra told him, "Sugriv, I'm sorry. You got badly beaten up." Sugriv said, "But why? You did not shoot your arrow. You had promised me that you would kill Vali. Why you didn't shoot the arrow?" And Lord Ramchandra said, "Both you brothers look alike. I could not differentiate between both of you. Both of you appeared same to me." This is very instructive. See how sensitive Hanumanji was to the needs of Lakshman. But Sugriv, unknowingly, out of his insensitivity, committed a Vaishnava aparadha against Lakshman by neglecting him, ignoring him, not serving him. And Vali also had a able and loyal assistant and servant. It was Sugriv. Sugriv served his elder brother Vali very nicely. But Vali completely ill-treated Sugriv. So Vali ill-treated Sugriv and Sugriv ill-treated Lakshman. Therefore, Lord Ramchandra here is saying that both of you looked same to me. Just see the depth of the words of Lord Ram. That's so deep. He's saying both of you are same. Vali ill-treated Sugriv and Sugriv ill-treated Lakshman. There's no difference. Both of you are offenders. I could not distinguish between both of you. And then Valmiki Ramayana describes that Lord Ramchandra says there is one solution. You wear a garland and go and challenge Vali again. then I will be able to understand that the one who is wearing garland is Sugriv, and I will not shoot you. I will shoot your brother Vali. I will be able to distinguish between both of you. Then Sugriv agrees, and Lord Ramchandra looks at Lakshman, and Lakshman immediately understands the heart of Shri Ram. Lakshman quickly goes and he takes some leaves from the forest trees, some flowers, and quickly makes a simple garland. Now Lord Ram could have told Hanumanji to make the garland. But no, he told Lakshman, and Lakshman quickly, in no time, he made a garland. And Lord Ramchandra told Sugriv, go and wear that garland so I can differentiate between you and Vali. And Sugriv goes in front of Lakshman. So for Sugriv to wear that garland, he has to bow down. Because Sugriv was big, huge, powerful warrior. So for Lakshman to garland Sugriv, first Sugriv had to bow down so that Lakshman could, without difficulty, place the garland around his neck. So Sugriv went in front of Lakshman, and as was customary when somebody is garlanding you, Sugriv folded his hands and bowed down. And then Lakshman, with his lotus hands, placed the garland of forest leaves and flowers around Sugriv's neck. So when Shripad Ramanujacharya explains, when Sugriv bowed down in front of Lakshman, Lord Ramchandra accepted that as he's asking forgiveness, he's bowing down, he's offering respects to Lakshman. And Lakshman placing the garland around Sugriv's neck, Lord Ramchandra accepted that as Lakshman has forgiven Sugriv. And then Sugriv goes with that garland, which represents the mercy of Guru Tattva, the mercy of Lakshman. And then he fights, and then Lord Ramchandra shoots his Rambaan, which destroys Vali. So much to learn from this. So much to learn from this. So we have to be very sensitive. Even other devotees may be going through a lot. We have to be sensitive to their needs. And then we'll discuss the last verse. I'm so sorry, we are going over time, but I will end quickly.
Naham na yajno na chayu yamanne ye deha bhajo manayascha tatvam vidu pramanam balavirya yorva yasyatma tantrasya upayam vidhitse.
Verse number 7, translation. Lord Brahma said that no one, not even himself, Indra, all the members assembled in the sacrificial arena, or all the sages, could know how powerful Lord Shiva is. Under the circumstances, who would dare to commit an offense at his lotus feet? Purport by Srila Prabhupada. After Lord Brahma advised the demigods to go to Lord Shiva and beg his pardon, it was suggested how he should be satisfied and how the matter should be placed before him. Brahma also asserted that none of the conditioned souls, including himself and all the demigods, could know how to satisfy Lord Shiva. But he said, it is known that he is very easily satisfied, so let us try to satisfy him by falling at his lotus feet. Actually, the position of the subordinate is always to surrender to the Supreme. That is the instruction of Bhagavad Gita. The Lord says, everyone to give up all kinds of concocted occupations and simply surrender unto him. That will protect the conditioned souls from all sinful reactions. Similarly, in this case, Brahma also suggested that they go and surrender unto the lotus feet of Lord Shiva. For since he is very kind and easily satisfied, this action would prove effective. So here Brahmaji is saying that we cannot understand how great, how powerful Lord Shiva is. Similarly, all of us, we may have read, we may have heard, but we really don't have the full realization of how powerful Vaishnava Seva is and how dangerous Vaishnava Aparad is. Our scriptures are full of examples of how little bit of Seva can give us so much benefit. How in his previous birth Narad Muni performed some menial Seva to the sadhus, and how by eating their remnants, by honoring their Mahaprasad, how he became such a great devotee, and how he got Krishna's grace. And here we see how powerful Vaishnava Aparad is. You may be a powerful demigod, Prajapati, Daksha, but if you commit Vaishnava Aparad, you will be destroyed. Daksha was beheaded, his yajna was destroyed, everything was destroyed. So it should humble us that we are conditioned souls and we don't understand the power of great souls. And in our day-to-day dealings, we really do not know who is what. Someone we may think is junior to us. Someone we may think was preached by us, was brought by us into Krishna consciousness. But we don't know. Tomorrow that devotee may become a very great, exalted, very advanced devotee. And we may remain not very advanced, who knows. There are so many disciples of Srila Prabhupada who did not even meet Srila Prabhupada in person. They were initiated through a letter. But today they are one of the greatest leaders, spiritual leaders in this world. Some disciples got very few moments of personal association with Srila Prabhupada. But today, they are the most exemplary followers, representatives of Srila Prabhupada in our sampradaya. So we really don't know. It depends on our sincerity. It depends on our level of surrender, how much advancement do we make. It depends on our personal sadhana, our personal bhajan, how much mercy we are able to attract from Guru and Gauranga. And none of us actually know what is the quality of another devotee's sadhana, because sadhana is personal. None of us can tell how attentive another devotee is during his or her japa. None of us know what prayers the other devotee is chanting. None of us know how advanced another devotee is. Therefore, we should be very careful not to judge other devotees, not to insult other devotees. And we must be very, very, very careful never ever to think ourselves better than another devotee. That is one thing we should never do. We should never think ourselves to be better than others. If we think we are better than others, at that very moment we will lose Krishna's mercy. Guru and Gauranga will withdraw their mercy if we think we are better than others. It is a great illusion to think that we are better than others. Jivera Swarubhaya Krishnera Nityadas. Everyone, even that brand new devotee who you think knows nothing, that devotee is eternal constitutional position. Swarup is that. That devotee is Krishnera Nityadas, eternal servant of Krishna. We should never think ourselves better than anyone. These were some of the thoughts I wanted to share about these three verses. Day before yesterday was the disappearance day of Srila Baldev Vidyabhushan and the appearance day of Srimati Ganga Mata Goswamini. Wanted to speak about both these great personalities, but we do not have time. We can leave that for another class. Jagadguru Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai. Ananta Koti Vaishnav Vrinda ki jai. Thank you all very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Danat Pranam, all glories to Srila Prabhupada and Guru Maharaj. It's a very, very inspiring class, especially how to deal with the devotees, how to not offend. Prabhuji, if you have time, you can actually explain some pastime of the Radevi Devasan and Gangam. Maybe.
Are you sure? Does anyone have objection to that?
Yeah, if anybody is busy or something, they can leave the go. I don't know, Prabhuji.
Yeah.
Okay, so what we will do is, sorry, go ahead. Somebody wants to say something?
Yeah, Prabhuji, if anybody has any question, let them ask first. And then,
okay, Mataji. Does anyone have any comments, corrections, or questions?
Hare Krishna, H.J. Ajita Dadavidas, Prabhuji, Koti Koti Dandvat Pranam to your Seva. Prabhuji, today we learn so many lessons from you, teach us from Bhagavatam, each and every, Sugriv, Hanumanji, Lakshmanji. Sugriv is not given a place to Lakshmanji, respect to that, and Hanumanji is given break the one branch and give a asan to Lakshmana, and then he sit down so that we can correct the Vaishnava, but by our behavior, you teach us this lesson and so many stories how we have to behave, how we have to forgive the Vaishnava. Thank you very much for wonderful class. Koti Koti Dandvat Pranam to you all. Srila Prabhupada, Srila Gurudev ki jai ho.
Thank you, Vrinda Gopika Mataji. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Hare Krishna Adi Gadadhar.
Hare Krishna Dandavat Pranam Prabhuji. Is this Bhakti Swarup Govinda Maharaj?
Das Dasanu Das.
Dandavat Pranam Maharaj. Hare Krishna.
We really appreciate you just open up our awareness for the Vaishnava attitude and awareness. I wanted to add one point to your last point you made. Considering that one should not think that any devotee is anything less than me. That's very vibrant. because it's the advancement, the scale of advancement is the compassion. It's because without compassion, one would inevitably will be drawn in the sense that since I know so much or I have a higher even ashram or seniority by age and different things. So I have that natural tendency in the conditioned life to lord over and to kind of lead that I am the leader. These tendencies creep in, but the sense of compassion will definitely save us from those tendencies. One perspective in that, because as you said, that every living entity is a part and parcel of Krishna, is a potential. So when we look at the potential of every human being, especially, he has the potential to attain the full-fledged love of God. And I have still to work up to it. In spite of my wonderful situations, I am endowed with all the wonderful mercy. We can think of how much mercy we all have received from other Vaishnavas and throughout our lives. And still I have a long way to go to attain the full fledged perfection. On the other hand, when we see other devotees or other people, we must think of their potential. They are endowed with the same potential. And whatever they are doing, we don't know their circumstances, as you mentioned very wonderfully. We don't know the circumstances why somebody acts like this or somebody speaks like this or behaves like this. So we always must give the benefit of doubt there. The intention is not bad. Because what happens, we think, oh, that person is, this devotee is well, bad intended, and that's why he's speaking like that. Immediately the judgmental aspect comes. But we must give this little space that his circumstances must be causing him to act in such a way, speak in such a way. But let us give him the benefit of doubt, and if we can help or assist him with a sense of compassion, because that is the only thing that will keep us on the right track of thinking. On the other hand, in spite of having such wonderful favorable situations in my life, I have still underachieved, you know. I have still underperformed. So, but on the other hand, other devotees, whatever good they are doing, in spite of their situations, I don't know what their circumstances, still they are performing so well. So in that way, we can always allow this space to appreciate others in spite of apparently their not so well expression thing, but the potential is theirs. They are no less, not an iota less dear to Krishna than we are aspiring to. Along those thoughts, I think you brought out the point very wonderfully. We really appreciate your presentation, and thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Maharaj. Thank you so much. It's always an honor to have you. And I hope when I come to India, I will be able to somehow associate with you and benefit more from your association. Thank you so much, Maharaj.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu. Oh, thank you for class. I have a question. I was wondering if Sugriv ever got the point or the message or the lesson that he should have offered a seat to Lakshman. I know he got kind of like maybe indirect reaction or something, but I don't know that he ever learned about his insensitivity.
Hare Krishna. So yes, Mataji, that's a very very good point that you have raised. So Krishna has his way of purifying everyone, and every soul has his or her own journey of purification. If we analyze Valmiki Ramayana, we see that this incident happens. So in a very indirect way, unknowing way, Sugriv seeks forgiveness from Lakshman, and Lakshman forgives him. But that full purification had still not happened. So when the friendship is made after Vali is killed and Sugriv is made the king of Kishkindha Kshetra, Chaturmas starts. And there is 4 months of rainy season, and Lord Ramchandra, being so compassionate, he knows that with the heavy rains, the search mission by the monkeys, the Vanaras, will be very, very difficult. So he tells Sugriv that let's wait for 4 months, let this monsoon season end. And as soon as the Chaturmas period ends, we will immediately start the search mission for my beloved Sita Devi. So Sugriv agrees, and Lord Ramchandra along with Lakshman, he goes to a cave and he stays there, intensely relishing the sweetness of Vipralamba Bhav and constantly chanting the names of Sita Devi, meditating on Sita Devi's wonderful qualities. And Lakshman was very lovingly assisting Lord Ramchandra in relishing that nectar of Vipralamba Bhav. On the other hand, Sugriv, because he was not completely purified, when he became the king of Kishkindha Kshetra, he got his wife back, he got the whole kingdom back, he had so many maid servants, such nice food. He completely gave himself to intoxication and sense enjoyment. And he completely forgot about his commitment to Lord Ram. And the 4 months of Chaturmas ended, the rainy season ended, and Sugriv was still completely engrossed in sense enjoyment, completely lost track of time, completely forgot about his commitment and promise to Lord Ram. And Hanumanji tries to wake up Sugriv from his slumber of sense gratification. But the real purification comes when Lakshman arrives. When Lakshman arrives at Kishkindha Kshetra. And he gives a good chastisement to Sugriv. And that is when Sugriv actually physically falls down at the lotus feet of Lakshman and begs forgiveness. And with an open mind, as we were reading in the first verse that we studied today, with an open mind, without any reservations, Sugriv admits his mistake. He says, I am a monkey, I am a vanar, and I am completely addicted to sense gratification. I am a conditioned soul. Please, please, please have mercy on me. I am sorry. I will do as you want. In fact, before you arrived, my well-wisher Hanumanji reminded me of my precarious situation. Therefore, I have sent messengers in all directions, and I have invited all the powerful Vanaras and all the powerful followers to come and assemble here in Kishkindha Kshetra so that the search mission can start immediately. And you can see some of the Vanaras are already returning from the forest to assemble here to assist Lord Ram in finding Mother Sita. So I have already started working on it, but please forgive me. So when Sugriv with an open mind admits his fault, admits his mistake, begs forgiveness and decides to take corrective actions, then Lakshman forgives him. And that is when we can understand that Sugriv completely got full direct purification and mercy. Does that answer the question, Mataji? So it's a journey, it takes time, but his actual open, honest confession, he admitted his fault and he surrendered to Lakshman at this point after the Chaturmas period ended. So it took 4 months for Sugriv to be completely purified. He fell down, made a mistake again, but then he was corrected by Hanumanji and Lakshman. And then there is no other mention of him falling down again. So does that help, Mataji? Does that make sense?
So, I feel that what you just narrated shows that he was remorseful about his neglect to honor his promised commitment to Lord Ram. But I still feel like the other question, you know, I'm not still seeing that he became aware of his neglect toward Lakshman, the deceiving thing.
Very wonderful point, Mataji. Is this Gaurangi Mataji?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. So it's not Shameshwari.
I identified it correctly this time. So yes, Gaurangi Mataji, this is a very, very wonderful point. And actually, there are parallels with Gaur Leela. So we need to understand this point very nicely. So yes, as far as Valmiki Ramayana is concerned, as far as Tulsidas Ji's Ramayana is concerned, there is no direct mention that Sugriv refers to that previous incident where he neglected to honor Lakshman and begs forgiveness for that. There is no specific mention of that. But we can understand, we can read between the lines, and we can understand that that realization and that transformation, it did happen. It did happen. And there is a parallel in Gaur Leela. Can someone guess what is the parallel in Gaur Leela? It is the very famous story of Devananda Pandit. Devananda Pandit offended Srinivas Thakur. And he served Vakreshwar Pandit. And being pleased with his service to Vakreshwar Pandit, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu forgave Devananda Pandit. But in Chaitanya Charitamrita, there is no specific mention that Devananda Pandit goes to Srivas Thakur and begs forgiveness like Gopal Chapala did. There is no mention, but there was a transformation of the heart. And when there is a transformation of the heart, you can understand that the person has begged forgiveness and received forgiveness also. That transformation of the heart is most essential, Mataji.
Yeah.
Does that help?
Yeah, because if there's transformation of the heart, then it is unlikely that given a similar situation in the future, they would commit the same offense.
Yes. Exactly. Yes, Mataji.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. I was kind of thinking like that when you were explaining the first time, but I just needed to confirm. Yeah, like you said, we need to read between the lines to come to that, you know.
Yes, Mataji.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you, Gaurang. Mm-hmm. On glory to Srila Prabhupada.
Oh,
Hare Krishna, Adigada Prabhuji, this is your servant Sachiplan Gaur Arida. Thank you very much for the wonderful lecture as usual, Prabhuji. Very nice lecture, very instructive lecture. Prabhuji, I had one comment. You know, whenever I hear lectures on offenses, I always feel that ISKCON, when somebody comes brand new to ISKCON, they should parallelly be taught about this offensive mentality. Because coming freshly into ISKCON, you know, we, at least most of the people come with, at least I came with a lot of bad propensities in my heart. So while I was practicing, you know, the first few years, you know, there's no talk about offenses at all. It's all about, you know, chant, eat prasadam, kirtan. Hearing Krishna Kada. But then as I progressed, you know, I came to understand this offensive mentality, and at least I was able to realize. So whenever I hear these lectures, I feel that, you know, somehow the topic of offensive mentality or anatani vritti or being sensitive to devotees, you know, all good points that you mentioned in the lectures, I hope or I wish or I pray that somehow these things will be instilled or inculcated or taught from at least not day one, but at least, a little bit into the process once somebody joins the process. I think that will help at least the newcomers. That's just a comment for you. But thank you very much for your lecture, Prabhuji. And you're not only lecturing. I see this in your behavior, your sadhana also. You are very nice devotee, very practicing very nicely. And you also educate others, or you also help others, coach others. So it's very, very inspiring for you. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Sachivan Gaurav Prabhu. I transfer all your kind words of praise and appreciation to Srila Prabhupada and Gauranitai. Thank you very much. So I just repeated whatever I've heard from Guru, Sadhu and Shastra. Thank you for your comment.
Hare Krishna.
Yes, Mataji. I just want to say one sentence. So, as you said,
I just wanted to ask the name of that Prabhuji.
Sachi Prana Gaurahari Prabhu. He's from Atlanta. He's one of our leaders in the Atlanta congregation. So, yes, as Sachi Prana Gaurahari. Yes, Prabhu, go ahead.
Now, you continue, then I will say.
No, Maharaj, I was just saying that, it takes a village to raise one devotee. It's a collective effort.
Yes.
So please go ahead, Prabhu. Yes, Maharaj, please go ahead.
Yeah, the nature of Bhagavad cultures, Mataji asked very, very practical question and you gave wonderful reply. We can reflect upon the very core nature of this Bhagavad culture which we are practicing. So in Bhagavad culture, always the focus is what will please Krishna the most, what will please Guru Maharaj the most. But our material tendency is always there. Let me be self-upgraded. Let me go ahead of everyone. Let me be recognized by Guru, or let me be very close to Krishna. It's the other way around. When we focus what will please Krishna the most. Like when we study all these wonderful expressions of pure devotees in Srimad Bhagavatam, just think of the Gopi Gita, suddenly. So when we study or read Gopi Gita, their expression, they are not our expressions, but they are meant to increase our tremendous appreciation for their love for Krishna. Their pain is not our pain, but we are pain because of their pain. So it's always the vicarious experience in this Bhagavad Dharma. We appreciate those who are so dear. We appreciate those who have such elevated love for Krishna, so much elevated love for service for Guru Maharaj. So rather than pushing oneself, it is always to show our genuine appreciation in action, in thoughts, in words, for those who are very dear to Krishna, dear to Guru Maharaj. That is the secret of success in this Bhagavad Dharma. So the tendency will become purified when we will see what is best for my own upliftment, rather than pushing myself ahead of someone. We must appreciate those who have so much endeared themselves to Guru Maharaj and to Krishna. This is how we study Srimad Bhagavatam. It is not that by reciting or by memorizing so many things, now we think that we are that elevated. Rather, we are only expressing our appreciation of those devotees who have such elevated thoughts and expressions for Krishna. So we follow through this. That's the meaning of Dasa Dasanu Das, that we appreciate those who are way, way ahead of us to become benefited in true sense, rather than thinking, now because I also know this, so I am at their level. We must never make that mistake. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Bhakti Swarup Govinda Maharaj. Thank you so much for enlightening us. Hare Krishna. So I feel personally that it is past 9 o'clock. It will take time to discuss Srila Baldev Vidya Bhushan even one past time. So he's a very great acharya in our sampradaya. I was thinking if it's okay, next time when we get a chance, we can discuss about the glories of Srila Baldev Vidya Bhushan and or some other speaker can do that in the future classes. That is just my humble request. Otherwise, it will get very late. We can do that next time. Is that okay, Shyama Gauri Mataji?
Yes, Prabhuji. Because it's already almost 9:10.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. All glories to Srila Prabhupada.
Since it's all Vaishnavas, Vanchakalpatarubhyasya, Kripa Sindhubhyevacha, Patitanam Pavane.